Okay, I decided to talk without a microphone, but you know, if back there, if you wiggle a hand, it means that you don't hear me, and then I will try to raise the volume. Okay, so I thank you very much all the speakers that introduced me, and I'm extremely honored to be here. You know, it's a very prestigious university in this exceptionally good research center and with this group of graduate students and also to be part of this series of lectures, which is also very good. So I am the honorary guy. So I am the one that has to thank. I wanted to add something on the LBB conditions. Since you know, this morning I had a meeting, a very pleasant meeting with some students, and I told them that in my career I always been extremely lucky, which is true. You know, so there are, like in Italy, there is the cousin of Donald Duck, which is a very, very lucky character in the cartoons. And so I will... So I will tell you shortly, not really the story of LBB, but what was behind the beginning. You know, when I was a postdoc, my boss decided that I had to go to Paris for 1 year to, you know, learn finite elements and you know, the numerical analysis from the Jacques-Louis Lyon's group. And at the time I had a fiancé, and you know, I was not very happy to stay 1 year without. And so the first week, she went with me, and we took a miserable hotel in Paris, and we stayed there. And I didn't show up at Paris 6. After 1 week, she went back to Pavia, and I went to Paris 6. And there was Javier, who was the big boss of the numerical analysis. I said, "Ah, you're here. Listen, last week I delivered a long lecture and I presented all the research subjects that I had collected during the summer." You know, that was October. And then I gave them to all the visitors and PhD students and postdocs, and they picked up, and there is just one paper which is left. So either you work on this, or you work by yourself. So I pick it up, and it was really disgusting. I would never have chosen that subject. It was a hybrid methods for plate bending by Pian and Tom. You know, I was not too familiar with the engineering literature because I was coming from a mathematical background. And I already had a lot of difficulties in reading and understanding what it was about, and basically didn't like it. But I had no choice. So I started reading, and it came out that that was the back door for the LBB condition. You know, everybody was working on Stokes. That was the big difficulty at the times. That was the beginning of the 70s, and for Stokes, everyone was trying to avoid this condition because it was extremely difficult to verify in concrete examples. So theoretically, basically, they understood that they could go through that, But they didn't want because it was then impossible to apply, or very difficult to apply. Instead, for hybrid method, it was simple. The verification was simple. So I went there. And then, okay, since it was a particularly simple case, I could also prove that it was necessary. So there was no way out. So basically, the message that arrived to the Stokes people was, okay, you are trying to avoid it, no way. You have to do this. And but, as I said, there is no good feeling from my side, no understanding that, you know, this is, you know, the subject that I should work on, and so on and so on. Sheer luck. And okay, this, I'm not saying that luck is necessary. If you are Terrestrial, you don't need any luck. Okay? I don't know if you know Terry Tao. I mean, you go to his blog, I mean, it's fantastic. It comes from another planet. But yeah, if you are only Franco Brezzi, luck helps a lot. So, let us see. Okay, now that's it, we work. Okay? This is the outline. And very shortly, I will give some very short generalities on numerical methods for PDE, just to show where is the position of these virtual element methods, which are brand new, within the other methods. And then I will describe some basic ones, like, you know, the analog of piecewise linear finite elements, you know, the most elementary case. And then I will discuss with a higher order. And already I will be satisfied that you understand up to here. Then I will show, but you know, the true smart thing is in here, in which we have now a trick to really make them work in a much more general situation. And so I will try to also give you this trick here and give example of applications. Now, I really doubt that I will be able to tell you about plate bending, but since I have one more day and several meetings with students, I would like to point out that it's there, and also there is, you know, elasticity, nearly compressible elasticity. I have the slides. I can discuss with the students if there are some of them which is interested on that. Okay? Well, so, let me start with the simplest model problem, which is a Laplace operator in 2D. Okay, basically, if it's too simple than that, it's not a problem. Okay? It becomes first year calculus. So, okay, you take Laplace operator in pre-homogeneous Dirichlet boundary conditions, and this is the variational formulation. I gather that everybody is familiar with that, otherwise we have a problem. Okay, and then when you discretize it, since it's a linear problem, you would like to discretize in general. It's not compulsory, but a problem like this is, it is. You would like to discretize the system of linear equations, finite dimension. So you would like to construct a matrix and the vector from the right-hand side in such a way that this has a unique solution, un, in Rn, and this solution is an approximation of the solution u of the problem. And of course, this being an approximation has to be very precise. Because one is a vector in Rn, and another is a function in H1Z. So. Okay, and of course, this is for every integer, so you want that the approximation becomes better and better when you have, when you spend more. Okay. Then, very roughly, I could split the numerical methods for a problem like that into two categories. The first is when basically your animal, your vector, which is the unknown, so the test function or whatever, is attached uniquely to a function in H1, 0. And then also the vector discrete solution will be attached to a function little u sub n, that will then be an approximation of the solution u. And in this case, it will be clear what that means. It means that the norm in H1 0 of u sub n minus u is small and goes to 0 when n goes to infinity. So that will be finite elements, spectral methods, wavelets actually, which are not there, radial basis function, extended finite elements, and now there is this new board. The other case is the case in which you do not assume that your unknown are representative of a function of H1, 0. For instance, this finite difference, you have the nodes, a grid, and your unknowns are the values at the nodes. And you do not necessarily attach a function to it. So that would be, for instance, when you say finite difference, or in a different context, finite volumes, mimetic finite differences, co-chains, and so on. Well, I will not speak about that. I have a whole package of slides on co-chains if some student is interested. Okay? Co-chains are, you know, the closest relatives to virtual elements in the other thing. Okay. So this is the general setting. And then something that I want to point out from the very beginning, considering now the closest finite elements. Now we stay the first group and consider finite elements, and in particular, continuous piecewise linear finite elements. The very basic. And then what you do is you consider the space of piecewise linear functions, and then you write the variational formulation. And of course, in a case like that, u sub n, you know, the vector in Rn, will be made by the values of these piecewise linear functions at the nodes. And from the very beginning, I point out that in cases like that, your computations will be done element by element. So you have a decomposition of your domain into triangles, and when you construct the matrix, you go element by element. Okay. In a more general situation, still finite elements, but not piecewise linear, you will have, you know, the typical finite element will be described by choice of the geometry. Could be triangles, quadrilaterals, more general shapes. And then you have the degrees of freedom, and the degrees of freedom per element, and then in each element the space of polynomials, which has the same dimension as the number of the degrees of freedom per element. In the previous case, you had the three vertices. Maybe I can go directly to the example, yeah. In the previous example, you had, you know, this one linear function is individuated by the values of these three nodes, a quadratic function is individuated by those six values, a cubic by these 10 guys, and so on. This is, and of course, you have to satisfy the continuity. Forget it. And then you have also isoparametric. Isoparametric, they are not polynomials. They start being the image of polynomials. But then you can still survive when you have some sort of isoparametric image of a triangle or a quadrilateral. But then, when you go to more complicated geometry with finite elements, you really face more important difficulties. Instead, and this is just a sort of a presentation of to to arouse your interest, in virtual elements you could have a decomposition of this big rectangle into four elements with the different four colors. And you see that, for instance, every one of those elements is not convex. The green element is not even simply connected. And also you have three nodes here that are, you know, all together, which are just highly forbidden in finite elements. So all this will not be a difficulty in virtual elements. So at least they are general. Okay. Try to sell my carpets. Okay. So let us see what they are. Assume that you want to split into pentagons, just to play. There is no reason why I should choose this. But of course, in particular cases, you might have a reason to have particular geometry, okay? Like, you know, underground oil field. You might have, you know, a different nature of the material that you would like to represent with one element. So, for instance, but you know, there are several. So now you would like to have an element which is a pentagon, and you should come out with a polynomial space of with dimension 5, which is not so obvious. Okay. And so the trick with the virtual elements it's virtual element 0.0. Okay, this is the first. So you say, okay, my unknowns are the values and the vertices. And then I take a couple of decisions. One decision is, from one node to another on the boundary, the function is linear. So if you know the values at the two nodes, you know the values on the edge. So having done this choice, you know, if I give you the five values at the five nodes, you know the function all over the boundary. So the boundary value of the functions are known, having taken this decision. Now, next decision. Inside, your function is harmonic. That's it. The function is uniquely determined, not computed, of course, okay? You just say, this is the function that I am interested in. Now the problem, how do you compute it, that's another question. But for the moment, we have a space of dimension 5, which is perfectly individuated. And you can see that, you know, the geometry does not influence too much. Okay. Then, you observe that every polynomial of degree 1 is linear on the edges and is harmonic inside. So your space, you have a space of dimension 5, and your space contains all the polynomials of degree less than or equal to 1. So you have a subspace of dimension 3 with, you know, 1, x, y. These are your three guys of P1. And then you have two troublemakers, which are functions that, okay, they exist, you know everything about them, but some explicit expression that allows you to compute. Then, you know, things like that were already present in the literature, and the typical solution at this point, the typical step was to say, okay, when I want to compute the local stiffness matrix in this space that contains functions that I cannot have explicitly, I will use some numerical integration formula. That is the typical answer. And instead, here we do something different. Let us see what is. Okay, So this is again our space in on the element, and now I want to compute the contribution of a single element to the global matrix. And I start saying, okay, I have a subspace of dimension 3, P1. What happens if one of the two entries is a P1? If one of the two entries is a P1, then this is what I should compute, and I integrate by parts, which is not too difficult. I can do that. The Laplacian of P1 is 0, so I have this term here on the boundary for every, you know, my functions are known on the boundary. Inside, I don't know them, but on the boundary, they are known. They're piecewise linear. So they can, I can compute them, all of them, on the boundary. So this is something that this normal derivative is a constant, so I can compute it. So if one of the two guys is a P1, I can compute the corresponding contribution to the final matrix. Now the problem is, what happens if neither one is a polynomial degree 1? Then we have to think. Okay. So, let us step one step backward. So we have a problem, variational formulation. We have a discrete problem with my V sub H is the space of, you know, locally functions which are harmonic and so on. And I have to cook out these two guys, A sub H and F sub H, in such a way that I have optimal order convergence, at least a linear. Okay? Since I don't have all the quadratics, I cannot pretend to have quadratics. Well, in L2, but I cannot pretend to beat the linears. So, if you try to do some analysis, you come out with these two conditions. Can you read all of them? Yeah, the red one maybe is too dark. No? Is it okay? Is it readable? Readable? Okay, whatever. Okay, so the first condition is that if one of the two entries is a polynomial degree 1, I compute it exactly. This is come for free. I already saw that I can do that. So this is done. Easy. And trivial. Then the other condition is, you see, is a stability condition. Consistency, stability. Is a stability condition that tells me that locally, on the diagonal, this is for symmetric, okay? On the diagonal, BVD, what I cook up is of the same order of magnitude of the true integral. But I don't want an approximation, you know? Previous was numerical integration. I was asking to be, you know, to compute those integrals with an error like of h square, of h something. Okay. Now I give up. I just want exact on P1. I want to be exact if one of the two is polynomial degree one, and I give up the rest. So if outside of the P1, I only need the right order of magnitude when h goes to 0. Okay? This is to lower and upper bound. And so if I can do that, I have two speeches, one for engineers and the other for mathematicians. So for engineers, if you have those two assumptions, then your patch test is satisfied. Okay? And so you are happy, pass test for the linears, okay? So if your solution on any patch of elements, if your solution is globally a polynomial degree 1, then your discrete solution will coincide with the exact solution. For mathematicians, well, you have an estimate, like you know, the H1 norm of the distance u minus uh is bounded by the interpolation, the best approximation that you can have in your space with of u with functions with, you know, piecewise linear on the edges and harmonic inside. And then u pi is different. So this is one h. This is an element by element. So you have an element by element approximation with polynomials degree 1. So, and this this u pi is not in H1. Okay. Is of course in H1 because it's a polynomial of degree 1 in each element. But there's no global continuity. So you realize that this, you know, both those guys are easily boundable, like you would do with finite elements. And this, of course, is the error f minus fh in the dual space. So, and okay, if you try to prove this theorem, I'll say basically the first time you try, you succeed. Essentially is what my good friend Hiroshi Fuji used to call subtraction mathematics. You add and subtract, and of course it does not require much imagination to know what you have to add and subtract, and you use your assumptions and basically you get the result. But of course, if tomorrow somebody wants to see it, I can finish. But it's easy. I mean, you cannot miss. If you did two proofs in your life on finite elements, you can do this one. So now the problem is how we easily have the first one, more or less, because we know that we can. Compute the result if one of the two guys is a polynomial degree 1, but then how do you manage in order to have the second one too? And then there is a crucial ingredient, and the crucial ingredient is the binomial. This is the guy, our guy, our champion, our Messi, not in the sense of confusion, but Lionel Messi, you know. Since we spoke about football. So our Messi is the pineapple operator. The pineapple operator is a sort of a projection onto the polynomials degree 1 according to the bilinear, the scalar product induced by the bilinear form. But be careful, this is element by element. So, on a single element, grad grad is not a scalar product because you are missing the constant. So you have to do something to tune up the constant. Okay. You do, and you do with this, for instance. Okay. You fix the constant requiring the average of the boundary is the same. And then you use this basically is like the projection. If this was a scalar product, it would be exactly the projection. Okay. So this is something that you can compute, and you can obviously compute because this is a product of grad p1, grad this guy, is a polynomial degree 1, and we already noticed that we can compute it by linear form if one of the two guys is a p1. So you can compute your operator by number. Can actually compute it. It will be a matrix 5 times 3 or 5 times 5. You know, on each element you have your pi lambda that tells you what is the projection onto P1 of every function. Once you have this pi lambda, you write this is the bilinear form, the original one, grad grad. Those are polynomials degree 1, so this you can compute, and then you add this term like here that will not alter. If u is u or v is a polynomial of degree 1, this will be 0. So you are just acting on those guys which are not polynomials degree 1, and on those, you basically need that the order of magnitude is the right one. So as S, you basically can take almost everything. If you have nodal values in 2D, you take the Euclidean product. Otherwise, if you are in 3D, you have to scale differently. But you just take the scalar bubble divided by H, right, by the diameter of the element. Okay. So this is how do you do it? If you do this, then you will have your assumptions H1 and H2 which are satisfied, and you have the pass test, and you have optimal error bounds. I'm sorry. Okay. It's more than 15 minutes. I was telling them that I cannot stay serious for more than 15 minutes. So I mean, I am allowed, you know. Okay, so you have your past test, you have your error estimate, you're happy. Now, for a while, this has been the situation. And then you start to say, okay, how can I go up with the degree? How can I do something which is, you know, this is P1. It's linear convergence. What can I do if I want, you know, quadratic, cubic, quartic convergence? Okay, let us see if we can repeat the stuff for polynomials degree higher than 1. Okay. You just need to have faith. If you have faith, you succeed. Okay? But you have to believe in Urania or whatever, the muse of mathematics, to be on your side. Actually, to me, the muse of mathematics is Euphorua, which is a nice name for the muse of mathematics. Okay, so. Then K bigger than 1. Okay. And look at what you should be able to compute. You want to repeat it, what you did, and you want to be able to compute the bilinear form when one of the two guys is a polynomial of the right degree. In this case, polynomial degree K. So, okay. You keep integrating by parts, mainly because it's the only thing that you know how to do. And so you do it, and then what happens? So here pops out Laplace of Pk. Laplace of Pk is a polynomial of degree k minus 2. Indeed. On the boundary you don't care, because you know the function v will be known on each edge by normal interpolation of the polynomial in 1D. You know, in 1D is not a problem. They were really big polynomials. You know. So in 1D, on the edges, v is known, and dpk over dn is a polynomial, so you can integrate. So assume that I give you for each function in the space, I give you enough information to compute the value of the boundary, and as additional unknowns, I give you inside the moments up to the order k minus 2. If I give you that information, you can compute this. So now the problem is we have to pick up a space before our harmonic. Now we have to change it to a new space in which I could use those moments as degrees of freedom. Okay, the boundary, that's easy. But the moments inside. Let us see. Okay. And then, okay. First, I say, okay, instead of having harmonic function, because I want to preserve all the polynomials, for instance, I want, for k equal 2, I want all the p2 polynomials to be inside my space. P2 polynomials are not harmonic. They have a Laplacian which is constant. So I have to allow the functions in my space to have a constant Laplacian. So this is what I will take. I take functions which have a Laplacian of the vk minus 2. And then, you know, on each edge of the vk, okay, you choose your degrees of freedom. In 1D, this is not. And then you have a useful lemma. I say, okay, I just look at the inside. So the boundary, I work with functions which are zero at the boundary. And inside, they have Laplacian of degree r. R with the k minus 2. Okay? And then, how many functions I have? Well, I have a space which has the same dimension of PR. And I tell you that the Laplace operator is an isomorphism in between this space here and the PR itself. And of course, I can take now as the degrees of freedom the moments of my functions up to R. Be careful. In the definition of the space, I take the Laplacian of V is a polynomial of degree k minus 2. As degrees of freedom, I will take the integral of my function against a polynomial of degree minus 2, k minus 2. Think k equal 2 is the simplest case. Okay? You have functions which have constant Laplacian. And as degrees of freedom, you take the value, polynomial degree 2 on the boundary, and the mean value inside, which I will identify in a unique way a function with a constant Laplacian at 0 on the boundary. Okay. We are very happy, and these are the spaces that come out. Okay? Now you see that the geometry is not so important. The geometry of the element is not an issue. It could be a quadrilateral, as in my picture, but it could be, you know, a pentagon. And also, you remember those VEM. You can do that on that geometry. We never use the geometry of the element. So we can go up. And similarly, now we can construct the pi nabla, which now will be a pi nabla k. And now I don't need anymore to set the constant because I have for k bigger or equal than 2, as degrees of freedom, I have the moments. So I have the mean value, for instance. So the constant is taken into account. So I use the mean value as degree of freedom, and then is this always this, let me call it projection, okay, onto the polynomial of degree k. That could be a sort of H10 projection, if you allow me this improper mathematical line. And then again, you do exactly the same. You write down your bilinear form like this plus this, and again, you satisfy a past test of order k, and so on. You are up with it. Finish. Or, are there problems? Well, okay. Before going to the problems, I want to underline that my pi nabla for every k from 1 to up is defined on functions of H1. I don't use the definition of the space. It's not a different operator in different spaces. It's the same operator on H1. Important. Remember that. The only is that in order to compute it, I need to know the value at the boundary and the moments up to the order k minus 2. If I know them, I can compute my pi number operator, no matter what the function is. Remember this. Okay, now, for a while I was finishing here, and then they say, what do you do in three dimensions? Why? Well, if you look, if you try to do the same thing in two dimensions, okay, then when you integrate by parts, you have this. Well, you will still take the Laplacian of MPK is MPK minus 2, and you will take as degrees of freedom the moments. So they will not change. But on the boundary, before you knew V explicitly, you know, because it was a polynomial. For instance, k equal 1, you knew at the two endpoints, and you say this linear. Also k equal 2, you know, at 3 points you construct the P2. Now, what do you do? Okay, you could, it is reasonable to give information on the boundary of the face, but then inside the face, what do? Inside the face, you would like to go back to your previous virtual elements in 2D. But for the previous virtual elements in 2D, you were able to compute to have the moments of V up to the degree k minus 2. And this guy is k minus 1. So for instance, there are other people in MFT, we make it find a difference, say, okay, you pay 1 degree of freedom more. But it's not 1, you know, it's from k minus 1 to k. So it's a big, when you go up, it becomes very expensive. So this is a drawback. And also, if you have, say, a zero order term, again, you just, okay. And then at the more general level, I mean, you know your pi nabla, but you will like, what you really like is to be able to compute the projection in L2. So you have a space of functions that you have to manage all the time, and you would be happy if you could compute explicitly the projection of each of those functions onto the polynomial of the degree k, which is the accuracy that you're interested in L2, the normal square projection. And you don't have it. But, okay, now I will introduce an additional notation. I will call PR star is the set of homogeneous polynomial of degree R. Because actually, when I work with my virtual elements on the boundary, you know, after all, on the face, I know the moments up to the order k minus 2. So I could project onto in L2 onto pk minus 2, but not on pk. So what I'm really lacking is the information on the projection of my functions on the homogeneous polynomials of the degree k minus 1 and k. At least k minus 1 to do the three things. So the idea is, okay, this, so one idea which is not too smart is that, okay, after all I know another projector, which is the pi nabla. why don't I use the pi naphtha in place of the pi zero, which is the L2 projection? Well, okay, it's true that they will not be too far away, but you will have to take care of all the errors, which is not so happy. But that could be, you know, sort of a mathematical duty. But still, you say, listen, I already know all the moments after degree k minus 2, which are not reproduced by the pi naphtha. The pi naphtha reproduces the mean value. It uses the moments of degree up to k minus 2, but it does not reproduce them. So you know the exact value and you take another one. Well, come on, this is, that's too ugly. When it is too ugly, you change the method, okay? Up to a certain moment, level of ugliness, you can survive. When it becomes too ugly, you have to invent something else. Okay. So this is the idea. Okay. Now remember that we have you have the projection on pk minus 2, so you just need the last two. So the idea is you increase your space, you take a bigger space. In your bigger space, you compute the pi naphtha, because I told you several times that the pi naphtha does not depend on the space. Okay. I told you, remember this, the pi naphtha does not depend on the space. So I take a bigger space and I take the pi naphtha. Pi naphtha is always the same. Then, in the bigger space, so the bigger space will be polynomials which are, you know, now I have 2D, of course. Yeah? So they have the right degree on the boundary, and inside they have Laplacian, not in pk minus 2, but in pk. So I'm adding dimensions at exactly the right amount of dimensions that I need. So I have the Laplacian in pk, and so I have a bigger space. And now in this space, I say, okay, maybe inside here, there are functions that have the projection of the pi naphtha and of the function on the homogeneous polynomial of the degree k minus 1 and k, which are equal. Okay. So you are down, the dimension is again the same as you started with. But now you can use as the degrees of freedom again the same as before. So look, I start with my original space is this one. Then I increase it by taking this space in Laplacian and PK, but then I require that the moments up of homogeneous degree k and k minus 1 are the same for the function and for the pi naphtha. And then I have I use the same degrees of freedom, and this is what I do. Okay, on each element I start on the bound. I have to construct my function and to compute its projection on L2. So I start on the boundary, then I consider I have the moments up to the degree k minus 2, and I compute the pi naphtha. Once I have the pi naphtha, I use the pi naphtha in order to compute the moments of the degree k minus 1 and k, and so I know all the moments. So that really looks dirty, isn't it? And you know, if you are Italian, you know that people will start this guy is cheating. As if everybody is coming out information of nowhere. It's not. I swear. I'm not this guy. Okay, slow motion. You know the values at the vertices and the moments on the edges. So you know your function at the boundary. Out of the function that you have at the boundary, you compute the pi-nabla. And once you have the pi-nabla of this function, which is exactly the same as before, but now you use the pi-nabla to give you the two additional moments that you need, because you sort of say, okay, let us take k equal 2. So we'll say, okay, let us, first I would pretend that that my function is, say, harmonic. And it's actually k equal 1. So the function is harmonic. And then, I say, okay, instead of having an harmonic function, I will take a function which has the constant of a plus, or p1 of a plus, but still constant. Just to understand the field. Take a constant of that. So instead of being harmonic, it's a little bit, right? It has a little bit of curvature inside. And then, but you have to decide how much. And you say, okay, I will take how much curvature in such a way that the mean value of the pi nabla is equal to the mean value of the function. And then your function inside will not be harmonic anymore, but you will need you will have all the information that you need. Okay, let us see. Okay, maybe. So in three dimension, what you do? In three dimension, you have your degrees of freedom will be values of the vertices, moments on each edge up to degree k minus 2, moments of order k minus 2 on each face, and the moments of order k minus 2 in each element. And then on each face you start, you know on each face you know this free information, and you can by the argument before, compute your function, or actually, not compute your function v, but you compute the function v at the boundary, and you compute all the moments up to the degree k. And the moments up to the degree k is the ones that you use when you integrate by parts. So you can do the computation with the integration by parts. Okay. So you see, when you integrate by parts, you have the degree k minus 2 here, and you have the degree k minus 1 at the boundary on each face. So I will go quicker here, because I want to show some numerical results. And okay, just the elements, how they look like. At the beginning, they are just like the cube, up to here, you know. This and this are like QK. But then, you gain a little bit with respect to the QK, because on the faces, you reduce, you have P1 on the face and not Q1 inside. So you have a gain. And, but the most impressive gain is that you do not depend on the shape. So all my argument did not assume that I had one shape or another. So okay, maybe So I want, for instance, to show you some results that show that when you collapse two nodes, the method do not suffer. Okay? Why finite elements do? And so we took, this is a uniform grid, and then we started collapsing. So this is, I think, 60% or 80% and 100% of the formation. And these are the solutions that basically look, visually they look equal. When you look at the error, actually, you would say, you know, the undeformed configuration seems to be decidedly better. Then it does not worsen too much. From 50% to 100% doesn't change too much. But from zero, but there, you know, the effect is due to a uniform grid. You know, uniform grid pays a lot in terms of, you know, not in terms of order of age, but so we started with starting from a grid which is already deformed, and then you collapsing the guys. And again, visually is the same, but now you see that the gain is still there, but much less. And you could see that then, you know, the generation when they collapse is not so dangerous. Okay, and also, instead, you could have like a geometry like this. This is a Voronoi tessellation, which is very cheap to produce. And with this geometry, if you go with virtual elements, no problem. So yeah, this is the solution. This is a finite grid. This is the discrete solution. Of course, this is Laplace equal to 1. Is a toy. And you know, the geometry could be, you know, the geometry of every single element is. But then, you know, I don't know if you notice in the team there was Alessandro Russo. Alessandro Russo is a very nice guy, but he cannot resist an intellectual provocation. So he started. He said, "Okay, why don't we take something like this?" Just to see if you have intrusions, you know? See if it works, see if the method works with a mesh like that. But a mesh like that, remember, these are, you know, each little square has a polygon of, I think, nine edges inside, which is a hole. So for every little square, you have two elements, one inside and the other, which is not physically outside. They say, let's see. And then, you know, just to show, this is this one. Okay? So let us see if it still works. So this is the, and okay, this is, so the blue one is a polygon, non-simply connected polygon with 13 edges. And inside you have a polygon with 9 edges. And we are exact on P1. So this is, say, the exact solution, or the solution computed on the usual grid. And this is the one you get with this crazy. And, okay, if you look at the error, this is 0.07. And then, when you double the mesh, 0.019 is a square, is h square, okay. 0.005. It goes like h square in L2, I mean, L infinity in this case. Okay. So that's impressive. So we said, okay, Alessandro, you're great. I mean, yes. And then say, but well, maybe. Sooner or later you will do this, you know, or this. And that was it. Okay. And then 1 week later. came out with the Pegasus. This is, you know, 82 vertices, okay? This is a little horse with 82 vertices, and if you combine them, actually, you know, this is the numbering of the nodes, you can combine them, and actually, you see, they go together. So he came out, well, thanks God he didn't take care of the boundary. Yeah, 400 sets, 400 Pegasus, you know, with 16,821 vertices. It works, believe it or not. But yeah, 81 vertices per horse, and you are exact on P1. So, I mean, it's really remarkable, you know. Then you go down and it stays there. Okay, so now I will jump to the conclusions. If somebody is interested in plates, I can tell more. Okay, this is usual finite element programming of C1 elements. If you try, it's like cod liver oil. If you try it once in your life, you don't forget. When you are 80, do you remember this time? Yes, I remember this. Okay, go to the conclusion. But what I can tell you is that, you know, for this is the error for plates. The construction of elements for plates, even on triangles, is much more easy than the usual C1 elements for usual finite elements. So, for instance, you can have shapes like, you know, this is a puck plate, is a Pac-Man, is a plate, and this is a Juventus plate, and those are the conclusions. So, okay, you have on triangles, C0 is the same as finite elements. You don't gain anything. CK is much easier. I did not really show much, but I can explain why. Because basically, in 2D for plates, you work only on the boundary. You know, the boundary is easy, even if you have function and normal derivative. The work that you do on the boundary is easy. Then inside, you do what you can do for polynomials, and for the others, you stabilize. But on random quadrilaterals, the robustness of these elements compared with the usual finite elements pays off. And of course, up to now, and possibly forever, of course, finite elements, once you know piecewise linear, you can do every problem with piecewise linear. With virtual elements, maybe you have to reason a little bit more. Okay, now you have these two projections, you use it for nonlinear problems and so on, but it's still something that you have to reason. Why for codes, you know, finite elements is still the best thing. And I am confident that this new trick will help applying those virtual elements to a more wider class of problems. Well, okay, I think that I kept you long enough. And thank you for your attention. Tomorrow I'll be here the whole day. I'm ready to chat with everyone. Okay. Apart from the cheap ones.
So thank you, Professor Brezzi, for this nice and very interesting talk. And thank you everyone for joining us. And now if you have any questions, please. Yes.
So everything that you presented is a spectacular in terms of accuracy, and how does it fare, how about the virtual element fare in terms of performance? So the FEM pools have been optimized to death.
Yes.
What about computation time for these crazy shapes?
No, okay. For Pegasus, okay, there is no game, okay? If you are so crazy to make, you know, polygons of with 82 edges, okay? No, I mean, for instance, with quadrilaterals, but it also depends on how you specify the geometric information on the elements. But, I mean, Alessandro claims that it's not so much worse than finite elements to have. Well, of course, if you start having quite different elements, you know, in one region you have triangles, in another region you have hexagons, then you have to sort of a bookkeeping on the shape of the elements. But for linear elements, this is not so big. The ones that we tested more heavily. As far as accuracy, of course, if you take a crazy shape, you should have a reason for that. So if you just take it like those horses for solving, you know, a smooth problem, then of course you're losing. And actually, something that we have to improve is variable coefficients. Variable coefficients compared with, you know, if you have a very complicated element and you compare with the finite element approach in which you triangulate the element and then you use usual finite elements on the subgrid. There, if you have a variable coefficient, this approach will take care of the different values of the coefficients in a different part of the domain. Our will not treat the whole element as one, and this has to be improved. We have to try to do something to have a good idea or so. But, well, it's not bad, but it's not as good as what you would have by subdividing the element in, say, triangles.
Is it easy to get from degree k to degree k plus 1?
Well, this is a very good question, but we didn't look yet. But well, also one has to distinguish in 2 and 3 dimensions.
Let's say 2.
No, 2 should not be. It depends on the degrees of freedom that you take. Because, I mean, on each edge, you could sort of take, like, you know, the genre.
So you can have some nestedness in this.
Yes, yes. And then, you know, the degrees of freedom, you are adding the degrees of freedom.
Right.
While, you know, in traditional finite elements, you move the domain. This is not the case. You have the moments, and then you just add one layer of moments. So, and then, well, you know, those comparisons depend a lot on the programmer. You know, a good programmer can survive.
I mean, another thing, would it make sense, if you have all this geometric flexibility,
mm-hmm.
would it make sense to go into another direction, not just making billions of these little crazy elements, but instead taking maybe possibly few, but complex elements that take special characteristics of your problem into account, and then use it even almost as a model reduction, because you
mm-hmm.
Have you ever tried this?
Yeah. What actually, if you look at the first picture by Alessandro, we have in mind to go and to see if you take those sub elements as inclusions of a different material. And to see, treating each one of them as one element, to see and to compare with this, we have in mind to do. Of course, as I was saying before, if inside the element you have a variable coefficient, then I mean the big element then you need those. But for constant coefficient inside, I think that could help. But there is, you know, they are brand new. I mean, the first paper came out in 2013. So you cannot complain that you presented new stuff, okay?
One last question.
Please.
You have now this much better understanding of that space, which you may not be able to describe explicitly, but you know something about the image under the Laplacian. Mm-hmm. So in this bundled stabilization business, you also look at global solutions. Mm-hmm. You know, say if your data are piecewise polynomials, they are of a similar nature. Does it have any bearing in this context?
The application of SUPG to those things is so far done only experimentally. No paper that is done just by using the stabilizing the steps, sort of. And not the bounds, you know. But of course we have the bounds in mind. Even both myself and Alessandro Russo, we have been in love with the bounds for years, and so it's one way or another we're going to use them. Are there any further questions?
Is it a real robot with respect to the geometry?
Well, for triangles, the angle condition is not really a condition on the error estimate. It's a condition on the error, say, in between u and its interpolant. You know, you have to, you know, in traditional finite elements, you have that u minus uh, assume that you have long and thin triangles, and you have been zombie enough to put the long edge in the direction of the gradient of the function. So a suicidal choice, okay? Okay. And then, the method will not really collapse, but because the u minus uh will always be bounded by the best approximation in the subspace. Is the best approximation in the subspace, which is wrong. So the best approximation that you have a function that goes like that. Okay? And then you take a long and thin triangle in this direction. That's your thing. And your best approximation with functions which are linear because the angles is bad. So in this respect, you still suffer. And that will not be healed by virtual elements. So if you take this, definitely, you can take the shape that you want, but if you insist on taking the most stupid one you can, there's no way. Okay, so this is more or less the philosophy. The philosophy is that you can choose, you have a lot of elasticity on the geometry so that you can really take a good shape and position of the element so that you are really approaching your function at best. If instead you play to lose, okay, then it's not robust in this respect. I will withdraw robustness in this region.